Good afternoon. I'm Doug Cox, and on behalf of the DC Lawyers Chapter, welcome to our July luncheon, our traditional Supreme Court roundup. What can you say? Once again, the end of the Supreme Court term has proven to be a mite disappointing for many members of the society and for many different reasons. After all, the Supreme Court sometimes seems the tiniest bit hostile to the society's values. The society, for example, is dedicated to the Constitution. We also believe in the separation of powers, the primary importance of our nation's history and traditions, and the notion that words have meaning. In these days, those views practically amount to thought crime. So while we call this event the Supreme Court Roundup, one has to wonder, how long before we are rounded up by order of the Supreme Court? Now, some of us, to be sure, will be rounded up for re-education. Some of us, however, will be fattened up and hunted for sport. So if you wonder why Justice Kagan was so keen to learn to shoot with Justice Scalia, now you know. There are a lot of notable opinions this term, but Justice Kennedy's majority opinion in the marriage case stands out for a number of reasons. Justice Kennedy wrote, "Choices about marriage shape an individual's destiny. The nature of marriage is that through its enduring bond, two persons together can find other freedoms, such as expression, intimacy, and spirituality. Marriage responds to the universal fear that a lonely person might call out, only to find no one there." It's clear that, whatever one might think of the decision, that in his lush and breathless mode of analysis, Justice Kennedy has been possessed by the soul of a 10-year-old girl. Indeed, rumor has it that in preparing his opinions, Justice Kennedy has taken to dotting his I's with little hearts and smiley faces. Nonetheless, we still gather together to review the just concluded Supreme Court term, to see what can be learned, despite what one justice has described as the court's mummeries, its interpretive jiggery-pokeries, and its silly extravagance. This year, we are delighted to have as our guide to the term Miguel Estrada. Like Jeb Bush, Miguel identifies as Hispanic. This is Miguel's third turn at the podium after appearances in 2011 and 2013. He will help us cut through the mummeries at least, although it may be that the jiggery pokeries are beyond even his great talents. We always like to have a little fun with statistics at these events, and it's easy to update our analysis from 2 years ago. Counting his tenure in the Solicitor General's office, Miguel has now argued a total of 22 cases in the Supreme Court. In private practice at Gibson, Dunn, and Crutcher, Miguel has had 8 Supreme Court arguments and won 6 of them. That's all the more notable when you look at the 2 cases he lost. One of them was a death penalty case in which he was representing a convicted murderer. His second loss was in a case in which he was appointed by the Supreme Court to defend the judgment below because the Justice Department refused to do so. The case involved the potential retroactive effect of recent amendments to the mandatory minimum sentence for crack cocaine offenses. Miguel was called upon to argue for retaining harsher penalties for some crack criminals. Unfortunately, a majority of the court wanted to make sure that when lonely crack criminals cry out in the night, someone is there to answer them. So it's not surprising Miguel lost that one. But putting aside the convicted murderer and the crack criminals, Miguel's win rate in cases for more typical private sector clients remains a remarkable 100%. Most recently, he represented the Republican senators in the Noel Cannon case, in which Miguel, together with Noel Francisco, garnered 9 votes for the proposition that the Senate itself gets to decide when it is in recess and when it is in session, and thus available to give advice and consent to the president's nominees. This is a text-based, common-sense proposition that was a significant limitation on President Obama's asserted recess appointment powers. In the course of the argument, Miguel rebutted the government's parade of horribles of all the bad things that would happen if the president's recess appointment power was limited. There is no parade, Miguel said, and there is no horrible. The only thing that will happen is that the president, heaven help us, will be forced to comply with the advice and consent that the Appointments Clause actually calls for. The Atlantic described Miguel's argument in Noel Canning as dazzling, and characterized the obvious ironies in his argument as, quote, a conservative icon denied a judgeship by a recalcitrant Senate may just have saved Senate recalcitrants. Others in the media have recognized Miguel's very great legal skills. The Legal Times has named Miguel one of the nation's top appellate litigators, noting that people who follow appellate practice in Washington have known for several years that Estrada is one of the best around. Law 360 picked him in 2013 as an appellate most valuable player. Washingtonian Magazine named him, quote, one of the true rising stars of the legal profession who could become one of the legends of the Supreme Court bar. Chambers named him in 2014 as one of the very top tier among the nation's appellate lawyers. He was also selected for inclusion in the 2015 edition of the Best Lawyers in America in numerous specialties, including appellate law, commercial litigation, and criminal defense. Miguel graduated from Harvard Law School. He clerked for Judge Kearse on the Second Circuit and for Justice Kennedy. His public service includes his clerkships and his tour in the Solicitor General's office, and also several years as a prosecutor in the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Southern District of New York. Miguel is a trustee of the Supreme Court Historical Society and has served as a member of the Board of Visitors of the Harvard Law School. In 2014, the American Lawyer named him a Litigator of the Year, 52 times more prestigious than being Litigator of the Week. And they praised his brains and tenacity and described him as a true clutch player, the lawyer to call for a tough, potentially unwinnable case. That's why we're so delighted he's here with us today, to perform the tough, potentially impossible task of explaining the Supreme Court's term. Miguel.
That's extremely kind and sort of awkward. When I got seated, since I'm sort of a continental fellow, I asked where the wine was, and only now do I realize that he was expecting me to turn the water into it. I am very, very touched by that kind introduction, cum ad for our law firm, Doug, and I will not dwell on it further other than to say that I'm thankful that I will not have to read the majority opinion in Obergefell, since you already did. That will save some slight awkwardness with the justice. I am very thankful to be here. I always enjoy this crowd. As you probably gathered, this is sort of more like sort of less of a roundup than sort of a memorial at an undertaker service. But we'll try to do the best we can with it. I'm thankful to be here for what may be the last time before Donald Trump has me deported. And so You know, we just take it one day at a time. Those of you who have been here for many years, including in the very old, old times, you know, we have a tradition of giving a single award to an individual who has exemplified egregious hypocrisy, crass dealing, and dishonor in public life. It's a target-rich environment. Naturally, though, my first thought went to Hillary Clinton, because, of course, you know, she had the whole thing with the servers at the State Department that, you know, her minions then conveniently destroyed so that they would not be available as evidence. But then I look at the actual reg involved, and it says that someone working at State, and I quote, shall use an email address established by the State Department. Given the very high odds that the Chief Justice would side with Hillary in this fight, I decided not to give her the award. I also consider Bill Cosby. You know, he's been waiting all year, the poor guy, for Bruce Jenner finally to become a woman. This is vodka. But I thought that was really a little bit unfair. I'm picking on the guy because Bill Clinton is still allowed to speak to adoring audiences, and he's allowed to take multiple millions of dollars from gay-bashing foreign governments through his RICO enterprise. I'm sorry, I meant his charitable foundation. So after, like, a lot of tough sledding, I decided that the obvious winner this year had to be Brian Williams. You know, as you know, he recently was fired as the anchor of the NBC Nightly News because of his false claims about what he did in Iraq and war service and whatnot. It's a good thing that the Stolen Valor Act was declared unconstitutional already. He wasn't really fired as much as demoted to a network that actually fits his talents. He is now at MSNBC, where he can join the other liars and fabulists. And so I think he is a worthy winner for our yearly award. Now, usually we start with the statistics. They're really depressing. And so let's just sort of say that the court had very few cases, 74 merits cases in total, including 8 summary reversals and 66 signed opinions. Only 30 of those were unanimous, as opposed to last year, where the hoopla was that everybody was holding hands and singing Kumbaya. 19 were 5-4. Now, the one signal aspect of the statistics is that, you know, the liberal justices really stuck together for the entire year like super glue, and the conservative justice basically took turns at giving them a fifth vote. One day it was Alito, another day was Thomas, another day was the chief. And that accounts for what Doug described as a not very happy term. Besides, obviously, you know, the merits cases, one case was digged, and another one was dismissed as moot after settlement. One case that had been granted to a pro se litigant was dismissed after he failed to file a brief at all. I mean, this guy, Bobby Chen, was his name. Everybody sort of assumed that Bobby Chen was dead because Tommy Goldstein couldn't find him. But ultimately, way after the deadline had passed and the case had been dismissed, Bobby Chen actually turned up with Paul Clement in tow. Nobody had any explanation as to how Bobby Chen, whose claim was that he had no sophistication about the legal process, had actually turned up at Bancroft. There were some eyewitness claims that Viet's limo had spent a lot of time in Baltimore. But that was never confirmed. You know, the Ninth Circuit led in getting overturned with 10 cases. Oddly enough, it led in sort of affirmances with 6 cases at the top of the pack. The 11th Circuit did worse, but, you know, the sample sizes are so small that this is sort of good sport, but it doesn't mean that much, except when it really happens to the 9th and the 6th Circuits. Let me see. The Justice Breyer voted 94% of the time with Justices Ginsburg, Sotomayor, and Kagan. The highest rate of agreement on the conservative side was between the Chief Justice and Justice Scalia at 84%. Justice Breyer, by the way, has a new book coming out. It's about the role of the court in the world and use of foreign law. Not clear, I haven't actually seen the galleys, whether the other worlds that he's actually speaking of are his own planet or other countries in ours. Now, excuse me, I know you're all thinking, this is really exciting as a term because we have same-sex marriage and raisins. But before we get to that, I feel that it's my obligation to give you a flavor of the types of cases that the court, thank God, spends most of its time actually dealing with. And so I'm just going to read them because these are so abstruse and unintelligible that it's impossible to actually say them in a declarative sentence. So in Alabama Department of Revenue versus CXS Transportation. Okay. Roll Tide. The court held 7-2 that the 11th Circuit selected an appropriate comparison class for determining whether Alabama's tax on diesel fuel purchases made by a rail carrier violates the Railroad Revitalization and Regulation Reform Act of 1976, but that the 11th Circuit made a mistake by failing to consider whether Alabama fuel excise tax is the rough equivalent of Alabama sales tax as applied to diesel fuel. I know you were dying to find the answer to that. In M&G Polymers versus Tackett, the court held that presuming retiree benefits best, it's sort of irrational in light of ordinary contract law principles. In Cummel versus Cisco, the court held that a belief regarding patent validity is not a defense to induced infringement. In Hanna Financial versus Hanna Bank, there was, you know, you probably guessed, you know, there was some claim about the confusion of the names. The court held that a jury rather than the court gets to decide whether trademark tacking is warranted. And B&B Hardware versus Hargis Industries, that is Hargis Industries, not Haggis, which is what I think we just had for lunch. So long as the other ordinary elements of issue preclusion are met, the usages adjudicated by the trademark trial and appeal board are materially the same, and therefore you can get issue preclusion. I will mention one last one because I see a critical mass starting to yawn. Kimball versus Marvel Entertainment, the court refused 6-3 to overrule a Justice Douglas precedent. You would think that just by saying that it was a Justice Douglas case, you would get 5 votes to overrule, but no. 6-3 in an opinion by Justice Kagan that was chock full of Spider-Man puns. I think I've tormented you enough with the boring cases, so I'm now going to turn to bankruptcy. and so, you know, the lead case, of course, is Bank of America versus Colquitt, which holds that a debtor in a Chapter 7 bankruptcy may not void a wholly underwater junior mortgage lien under Section 506D of the bankruptcy code. This is sort of boring, obviously, but it sort of serves as a reminder that if you want a case to be overruled, you should ask for it. Six justices joined a footnote saying, you know, the applicable case was really sort of dumb, but since, you know, the side that lost kept insisting that they didn't want it reconsidered, you know, they weren't. Then there was the Wellness International Network versus Sharif case, which brings the always entertaining Anna Nicole Smith back to the Supreme Court for yet another engagement. 3 years ago, in Stern versus Marshall, the court held that claims that otherwise would exist outside of the bankruptcy were not suitable for a bankruptcy court. They were suitable for Article III courts. In this case, the weighty issue was whether the party's consent made a difference to that. And the answer is yes. A bankruptcy court can hear a Stern claim if the parties, in fact, give their consent. This, again, would be a boring case, but for the fact that the Chief Justice wrote a really impassioned dissent, which culminated in his closing paragraph with text borrowed from a man from all seasons. And it said, "It profits the court nothing to give its soul for the whole world, but to avoid Stern claims." I don't understand what brought that on, but I think, like, maybe like every other Catholic, the chief had a secret fantasy to bring Anna Nicole Smith and St. Thomas More together in the pages of the U.S. reports. There is some agency cases. I'm here all week. First is the McLean case that shows that if an air marshal is told that there is a terrorist threat that is looming, which of course in government naturally follows all air marshals being taking up service, he does not violate the law and may claim whistleblower protection when he goes to MSNBC, where else, to tell his tale. In the Paris case, the court overruled the Paralyzed Veterans Doctrine case from the D.C. Circuit. I think Larry Silberman, who was the author of Paralyzed Veterans, is still in therapy. But you know, the court held that this was a textual doctrine. Interestingly, three justices, Scalia, Thomas, and Alito, wrote separate concurrences to call into question whether the court should continue to give deference to administrative interpretations of an agency's own regulation. In Department of Transportation versus Association of American Railroads, argued by our star partner Tom Dupree, the court held that Amtrak is a governmental agent for purposes of the Constitution. That mostly merely kicked the can down the street, as Justice Alito pointed out in a concurring opinion, because then you have to deal with the Appointments Clause and all of the other parts of the Constitution that would seemingly apply. At the very end of the term, in Michigan versus EPA, shockingly by a vote of 5-4, the court held that it was irrational under the APA for an agency to disclaim having to make any inquiry into the cost of a regulation where the purported benefits of the regulation were $4 to $6 million and the costs were $9.6 billion a year. The court split 5-4 in concluding that that was not a rational use of governmental power, and that the agency at least should think about whether this was a good thing to do. We had some cases on the immigration front, you know, the big issues, such as whether you can grant wholesale amnesty under the Constitution if you're the president. That issue is not yet at the court. You know, the APA issue is in the Fifth Circuit. The issue whether if you're a Cuban immigrant who has a child in Calgary, Canada, whether you can see your son grow up to be president of the United States, if people ultimately grow to like him, that issue also was not at the Supreme Court. The court did consider, however, in Melulli versus Lynch, the most important of all immigration questions, whether if you come into the country concealing unidentified orange pills in your sock, whether you can actually be turned out. And the court shockingly said 7-2 that no, you couldn't. Justice Thomas described the reasoning of the majority in his dissent as turning on, quote, a gut instinct that an educated professional engaged to an American citizen should not be removed for concealing unspecified orange tablets in his sock. Fair enough. We also had another, perhaps more telling immigration case in the case of Kerry versus Dinn. Dinn married what was described by the plaintiff as a civil servant in the Taliban government, more charitably, you know, described as somebody who'd been on the payroll of an Islamic terrorist state that is devoted to the destruction of the United States. And she insisted that she had a right under her fundamental right to marry to bring him into the United States. Shockingly, he was somehow excluded. You know, the explanation went something along the lines of you are, you know, on the payroll and doing, you know, the bidding of a terrorist Islamic government who's sworn to destroy the United States. Somehow the Ninth Circuit ruled for, you know, the marriage right in this case, and the court, by a vote of 5-4, disagreed that this was an appropriate use of the fundamental right to marriage. Interestingly enough, this case came down about a week or so before the same-sex marriage case, and it had a lineup that it was, you know, the justices in the five-justice majority were split into opinions. Scalia, the chief, and Thomas took the view that there was not such a fundamental right. And I read that opinion and concluded that all of the people that were urging the Chief Justice to be on the right side of history were probably going to be disappointed. There was a separate opinion by Justice Kennedy and Alito which concluded that insofar as the Ninth Circuit had wanted this woman to give a hearing as to why her husband would not be let into the United States, it was already obvious that being on the payroll of an Islamic terrorist state devoted to the destruction of the United States was a good enough reason. The court did not explain, however, why the winning party in the case, Secretary of State John Kerry, who seemingly is also on the payroll of an Islamic state devoted to the destruction of the United States, gets to stay in the country. All right, having sort of dipped our toe into crimes, let's do something about, you know, the criminal law and go through some of the criminal cases that we had in the term. You know, there were many. I won't force you to slog through all of them. Just know that if you plan to distribute a controlled substance analog, the government cannot come after you unless you actually knew it was a controlled substance analog. That's what the McFadden case says. We had any number of cases under the Fourth Amendment. Somewhat unusually, none involved bodily fluids and only one involved a dog. And so let's start with, you know, the Fourth Amendment case that led the pack. It's called Hine versus North Carolina. Now, you may know if you follow, the Clintons, you may know if you follow the criminal law that sometimes if cops make errors of fact and those errors are reasonable, you may still get the evidence in. Usually these issues are considered under the rubric of the exclusionary rule, but there is case law under the Fourth Amendment saying, for example, that when you don't have a warrant and you show up at the doorstep and a woman opens and you think it's the girlfriend, but in fact she has been ditched earlier and she doesn't have authority to consent, the cop could think reasonably, I had consent and that's okay. That's an error of fact. Now the question in this case is whether an error of law is entitled to the same type of treatment. If a cop makes a mistake on what the law is, does he get a break for that? And so the facts were sort of interesting. The cop is sitting by the side of the road, and Javier Vasquez drives by in a Ford Escort. And those two crucial facts, of course, caused the cop to start following the Ford Escort. Until the Ford Escort came to a stop at a traffic light, and it became obvious that only one of the brake lights was working. Aha, this is a grant for a stop. It turns out that Mr. Hine, the defendant in this case, is sleeping in the back seat. There are drugs, shockingly, and all of this ends in a criminal trial and conviction. Unfortunately for the cop, it turns out that North Carolina law requires only one stoplight, only one brake light. And so the issue is perfectly teed up with the Supreme Court, whether making a mistake on a question of law really entitles you to get the evidence in. And by a vote of 8-1, the court said yes. I think this may not be a very broad ruling. It is certainly not an invitation for the cops to ignore the laws or not learn them and hope for the best. I think the ruling may have been mostly driven by the utter incredulity of all of the justices that it's really true that North Carolina only requires one brake light. That takes us to our next case, which is a road stop case, Rodriguez versus the United States. If, the whole press thing does not work for Donald Trump, he can always become a sheriff. So Rodriguez is stopped at the side of the road. He's driving on a median. He gets his papers checked, license, registration, insurance. They do a warrant check. And after all of this is done, he gets asked if there can be a dog sniff of his car, and he says no, he wants to go. Now, there was a 2005 case, Illinois versus Caballes, stop me if you see a pattern, had said that if you conduct a dog sniff while you are doing the stop, while you're checking for the warrants and you're checking, the license, that is not a search and that is not a Fourth Amendment violation. The court held in this case, however, that if you do the sniff after you've concluded the license check and the insurance check and the warrant check, when the stop is essentially over, the guy has the right to go, and you cannot prolong the stop even by a de minimis period of time without an independent, significant Fourth Amendment justification. So that is, the Rodriguez case. The third Fourth Amendment case, I'm trying to take my watch in just to make sure that I don't understand my welcome. The third Fourth Amendment case is City of Los Angeles versus Patel. It's the motel case. Apparently, I did not know this, but the city of Los Angeles has a real significant problem with what is kindly known as taxi meter motels. You pull up and you use the facilities for 20 minutes. I hear the Clintons are doing a lot of campaign swing through California. In any event, so they have an ordinance that says that, the cops can show up unannounced. And demand to look at all of the guest registrations. And the issue was whether that complies with the Fourth Amendment. The court held that it does not, that you need at least an administrative warrant, which is not that hard to get under Camara and C, earlier cases from the 60s, but you cannot show up unannounced. The court turned down the effort by Los Angeles to analogize this to heavily regulated industries like gun dealers, liquor dealers, and junkyards, and those cases were effectively limited in Justice Sotomayor's opinion. Interestingly, there is a separate holding which seemed to cause no great heartburn for mostly anybody, that you can have facial Fourth Amendment claims. Those had been thought to be rare before, but I guess we can see more of them in the future. There is one interesting confrontation clause case. For those of you who are as old as I am, which means you went to law school in the Stone Age, all of the hearsay issues that may come up under the confrontation clause used to be ruled by a test that had been expressed in a case from the 1970s called Ohio versus Roberts. And basically, you let in all this hearsay if the hearsay had adequate indicia of reliability. Now, in 2004, in an opinion by Justice Scalia that was unanimous, the court overruled Ohio versus Roberts and started out on a principled basis to look at the text of the Sixth Amendment, require real confrontation, and turn the fundamental issue into whether the particular statement is viewed as testimonial, which is the type of statement that has the formality that would be made in a courtroom. Are you intending for this to be used in a courtroom? Is it part of the investigation? That sort of stuff. That would be all fine and good, except that since then, Justices Sotomayor and Alito, both former prosecutors, have joined the court. Neither of them is in love with the Crawford rule, and both of them, I think, sort of pined for the Ohio versus Roberts rule. And Justice Sotomayor had one of these cases a couple of years ago that provoked a bitter dissent by Justice Scalia. And in this one, Justice Alito wrote the opinion of the court, which somewhat surprisingly started out with a description of the test of Ohio versus Roberts, and then moved on to say, and there's also Crawford. And so ultimately, pretty much everybody agreed that the three-year-old who had been abused by his stepfather, who incidentally had sent the mother of the child and his girlfriend off to engage in prostitution to give him money, he had been abusing the kid in the interim, and the kid had told the school authorities. The court concluded that was not testimonial because a three-year-old child has no conception of testimony or courts or formality. Justice Scalia did agree with all of that, but he wrote a very, very angry concurrence in which he even refused to name Justice Alito by name and repeatedly referred to him as the author of today's opinion. He stated that he was writing solely, quote, to protest the court's shoveling of fresh dirt upon the Sixth Amendment right of confrontation so recently rescued from the grave in Crawford versus Washington. And so he ultimately chalked up, all of the opinion by Justice Alito as displaying his hostility to Crawford and its progeny, perhaps aggravated by inability to muster the votes to overrule them. But, he added, Justice Scalia did, snide detractions do no harm. He ought to know. Then we had a completely boring case, which is the death penalty entry for this year, Glossop versus Gross. And it was basically a rerun of the base case that we had a few years ago on what drugs can be used for executions. I was reasonably sure that this case was going to turn out in favor of the execution because there were multiple petitioners that first sought a stay from the court. And the first one who, not coincidentally, perhaps, was being put to death because he had raped and killed, I think, a 22-month baby, was executed when his stay application was denied that same night. Four justices, the four liberal justices, would have voted to grant a stay at that time, but did not vote to grant certiorari. They voted to grant cert on the papers for the remaining defendants on the same petition 1 week later. And so it was sort of interesting, right? I mean, there was no way that this case could turn out any other way. If this turns out to be a real claim, then the four liberal justices really would have had blood in their hands because they let the guy die. And if Justice Kennedy somehow thought this was a claim, he also had blood in his hands because he let the other guy die. And so I was pretty sure that this case was not going to turn out that poorly. We had some ADIPA cases that are sort of boring, so I won't really dwell on them because I'm already tormented you with some of the boring cases. There are some regular criminal law cases. There is Henderson versus the United States, which deals with 922G, 18 U.S.C. 922G. And it basically makes it a felony for a felon to be in possession of a firearm. So what if you have a firearm and, the cops take it from you, and it's obviously your property? And the question is whether you control the disposition of the firearm by directing that it be given to somebody else who's not under a legal disability. The government argued that that was not possible because that would be constructive possession and would violate the statute. The court disagreed. It's not clear, what would happen to all of these guns if the government had won. Maybe there is a big OPM warehouse where they keep, the Ark of the Covenant for the Chinese. By the way, I'm told that the OPM person just actually quit. I don't know what took so long. I mean, I got my letter telling me that all my information was in Beijing about 3 weeks ago. The court also had a very important case dealing with the very well-known statute, the Armed Career Criminal Act. And there has been a very contentious fight over the years in the court. This gives enhanced sentence to people who engage in certain felonies. Long story short, the court has struggled for years and years and years trying to figure out what possibly the residual clause of the statute means. It sort of covers conduct, quote, that presents a serious potential risk of injury to another. This year, in an opinion by Justice Scalia, the court finally gave up trying to come up with a meaning for that and declared the statute unconstitutionally vague. Now, my funnest statutory case of the year is the Fish case, Yates. As part of Sarbanes-Oxley, Congress passed Section 1519. Section 1519, I have it right here someplace, let me find it, makes it a 20-year felony for anybody who knowingly alters, destroys, mutilates, conceals, covers up, falsifies, or makes a false entry in any record, document, or tangible object. Mr. Yates is a fisherman. He was out at sea, and he had some grouper, and some government agent came by and ascertained that the grouper were undersized. So, exercising the usual quick wit that our government usually does, he said to Mr. Yates, go back to port and I will take the fish there, I'll see you there. Shockingly, when Mr. Yates got to port, the shore grouper were not there. And so naturally, he was indicted under the anti-shredding section of Sarbanes-Oxley, naturally. Because, you have destroyed, concealed, mutilated, cover up, falsified, or made a false entry in any record, document, or tangible object. I had thought that, a fish was not the type of tangible object into which you could actually falsify or make a record unless you're a crime family. And that ultimately, to make this story short, is how the court ended up. The court ended up saying that the most natural reading of the statute is that although a fish obviously can be touched, and is tangible in that sense. In the context of the statute, it did not mean that everything that is tangible and can be touched is covered by the statute, such that if you destroy it, that's a 20-year felony. This really meant computer drives and things of that nature. So if by any chance you know of anybody who has set up a computer drive to evade investigation or to obstruct justice and subsequently has destroyed it, Section 1519 might be the appropriate statute. We had a couple of business cases that are worth mentioning. The first one is a CAFA removal case, Dart Cherokee Basin Operating versus Owens. The court held 5-4 that if you file a petition for removal, you don't need at that time to provide the evidence that supports all of the removal. You have to have just a pleading. You know, the case was 5-4 because the four justices, all of whom are, you know, right of center, did not believe the court had jurisdiction over the case. And that's sort of important in the business context. What had happened was the Court of Appeals had declined to accept a discretionary class action appeal. When that happens, the conservative justice thought the Court of Appeals never actually acquires jurisdiction, does not pass on the merits, and therefore the Supreme Court couldn't rule on the merits either. That is somewhat dismaying for those of you in the business community, right? Because if you're hoping to take some of these extravagant applications of Dukes and Comcast to the Supreme Court, many of the courts that are inclined not to read either case for what it's worth will decline review in the Court of Appeals, and that automatically ensures that every vote you won in the Supreme Court will not be available to you. We also have, you know, the Abercrombie case, which had to do with disparate treatment claims. This is a case in which an employee applicant showed up wearing a headscarf. Abercrombie apparently turned her down without making any inquiry, based apparently on their policy that they don't like anybody wearing any clothing. And ultimately, you know, the case went to the Supreme Court, where Justice Scalia said that she might have a claim and it was not necessary that the employer actually be on notice that she might have a, you know, religion basis for this. We also had Young versus UPS, having to do with claims under the Pregnancy Discrimination Act, which succeeded in this case. It's probably not something that you need to know, except that the statute used to be confusing on its face, and now with the overlay of a prior opinion, it's unintelligible. Finally, on the business case, we have the Omnicare case, which is a securities case, which deals with the weighty issue whether there can be false statements of opinion and how you go about proving them. If you say, I believe that my business complies with the law, obviously it is a fraud if you in fact do not hold such a belief. There is a lot of murkiness left by Justice Kagan's opinion on the question whether, if there are objective facts that should have put you on notice that that wasn't actually not true, whether your belief actually was not a belief or something. All right, I've tormented you enough, so having dipped into criminal law and then forced you to listen to boring stuff again, I'm going to go back to the First Amendment. We start, of course, with Anthony Douglas Ilonis, better known to some of you who follow rap as Toned Doogie. Toned Doogie apparently had a real bad falling out with his girlfriend, or actually wife, who moved. And then he decided that the best way to deal with the situation was to write really hateful rap lyrics that he learned at a conservatory, I imagine. That basically, you know, threatened, you know, the wife, an FBI agent, a local school playground, and everybody, his employer, with various forms of murder and mayhem. Shockingly, he was prosecuted under Section 1875, which makes it a crime to transmit threats in electronic commerce, since he was pasting these things on Facebook. His defense, or his attempted defense, had been that he was really expressing his First Amendment rights as a rap artist, and he was just like Eminem. I listened to the argument. I wasn't really clear why that was a defense, but that didn't make. The court did agree with him that it was inappropriate for the instructions to the jury to convict them merely because the object of the threat could have understood, or a reasonable person could have understood this to be a threat, rather than he meant to at least or disregarded some risk that this was actually a threat. He and his counsel, you know, described this as the true threat case. So apparently, you know, the aim here is to say that you really have to subjectively mean to threaten, as opposed to do everything to put the fear of God and the bejesus out of the woman that you're threatening to kill. But that's, you know, the First Amendment for you. Then we have Reed versus Town of Gilbert, which is a very entertaining case that can only come out of places like the Ninth Circuit. So the Town of Gilbert has this sign ordinance code, which is very elaborate. I mean, it makes distinctions about, you know, political signs, ideological signs, and then there are temporary directional signs. So for purposes of what you need to know, if you are running for office or running some sort of ideological campaign, you can have a really big sign and leave it on forever. If you have a temporary directional sign that says, my church is meeting around the corner, come pray with us, you can have it like a smaller sign, and you have to take it within the hour after the event is actually over. You have to note when the event is. This was challenged, somewhat surprisingly, as a content-based regulation of speech, and in keeping with the zeitgeist, you know, the Ninth Circuit concluded that this, in fact, was not content-based at all. The case went to the Supreme Court, which concluded that if you make distinctions between ideological speech and other types of speech that might be content-based, and there wasn't really all that much inquiry to be added to that into purpose or object. Justice Breyer's opinion, let me first deal with Justice Kagan's opinion, which described the case in a concurrence as this was an ordinance that failed strict scrutiny, intermediate scrutiny, or the laugh test. Justice Breyer, however, was troubled that, you know, bureaucrats will not be able to make these sort of signs, and he sort of proposed a balance and test of the importance of the bureaucrat sort of aim and the First Amendment interests, because that's just exactly what the First Amendment has in mind. Then we go to Williams Yulee versus you know, the Florida law. I mean, excuse me, the Florida bar. We learned over the past several terms that if Congress deals with the very pressing national problem of stiletto-clad women stomping on mice, that is forbidden by the First Amendment because that's cruelty to animals, but it's content-based. If you are a hateful church that is picketing, you know, the funerals of people who have fallen in battle, that too is protected by the First Amendment. But after Williams Yulee versus the Florida bar, if you're a state judge in a state that allows elections and you want to solicit, you know, the public in a posting or a mailing for support, that is not allowed by the First Amendment. That is actually the holding of the 5-4 court in Williams Yulee. This is one of the cases that stands for the proposition that judges are different. The Chief Justice pretty much accepted everything that the challenger was saying, and that included, you know, the following. Under the Florida rule, as in the rule of many other states, a candidate is not allowed to personally solicit a contribution. A candidate, however, is allowed to have a committee that will solicit the contribution for her, and is allowed to write a personal note of thanks when the money comes in. Now, the candidate sort of said this is sort of irrational, is under-inclusive and over-inclusive, and it doesn't make any sense. The Chief Justice concluded that, no, this was okay, that Florida should not be punished for allowing some forms of speech, and that the fundamental lesson to be drawn is that this is okay in this special circumstance because, I quote, the role of judges differs from that from the role of politicians. He did say that. Somewhat more surprisingly, all of the liberal justices joined him. You know, there were the dissents by some of the conservative justices. Justice Scalia somewhat awkwardly, you know, described, you know, the majority as looking for a fig leaf, an image that I really did not want to have in my mind as to any of them. And Justice Alito described, you know, the ordinance as narrowly tailored as a burlap bag, which may have been generous. Justice Breyer commanded a 5-4 majority in Walker versus Texans Division of the Sons of Confederate Veterans. And this is the license plate case. This is you know, one of those cases in which one of the conservatives actually gave the fifth vote to the liberals for an outcome that seems sort of puzzling. In this case, the fifth vote was Justice Thomas. Now, Texas allows about 350 vanity plates, essentially. If you have a group that wants to have your own plate, if you went, you know, if you're an Okie or maybe Roll Tide, I'd rather be golfing is one of the allowed things. In any event, 350 of them, the sons of the Confederate veterans, went to have one of these plates issued and pay all the appropriate fees with the Confederate flag. This is turned down on the theory that this was not a very nice speech, and oddly enough, they sue under the First Amendment because they've been denied, you know, this plate on the basis of their speech. The Supreme Court gets out of the problem basically by announcing an opinion by Justice Breyer that there isn't a problem, and that this is okay because this is not speech at all, it is Texas speech. And so when you see the number in the state of Texas, that's Texas speech. And when you see I'd rather be golfing, that's also Texas speech. When you see Oklahoma on the license plate, as Justice Alito pointed out somewhat treasonally, that might be Texas speech too. And so Justice Alito has a very entertaining introduction about all the various plates, which he then puts in an appendix to his dissenting opinion, basically for the proposition that this is a ludicrous, you know, way to rule on the case. And I think it sort of is. I think it's hard to say that all of these messages are really the messages of the state of Texas. I think it would have been worthwhile for Justice Thomas to explain why he signed on to this opinion. I suspect that the Confederate flag had something to do with it, but it, you know, we could have a very healthy discussion about whether there's certain forms of speech like cross burnings or the Confederate flag maybe that are so unique in conveying only hate. That's a debatable proposition, but let's say that's what it is. That would be not a crazy doctrinal category. The Justice Breyer category about how this is clearly, you know, the state of Texas is, you know, has much less to commend it. There are other constitutional cases. I'm trying to march through this quickly. I think I will skip Comptroller versus Wynn, which deals with a Dormant Clause challenge to the taxation in Maryland. You know, the short story is that you get a credit for toward the state tax in Maryland, but not the county tax for taxes paid in other states. This is of huge importance to partners of Gibson, Dunn, and Crutcher who live in Maryland, like Doug Cox, but not otherwise significant to anybody, because if you choose to live in Maryland, my view is you had it coming. We also had, you know, the famous racing case, which deals with one of those remnants of a New Deal program, which in order to stabilize market prices, dictates that the Department of Agriculture can come up and physically take part of your crop in order to stabilize, you know, the market. Not that you have to destroy it yourself, or not that you cannot sell it, but physically comes up, pulls up with the truck and takes them. The court had no difficulty, although the Ninth Circuit had gone the other way, in concluding that this was a takings under the Loretto line of cases, because you physically were taking, you know, the raisins. Then we have the Alabama redistricting case, which is a complicated mess. It's sort of, at a very high level, it's about the redistricting of the Alabama legislature after the decennial census. Are you still there? Okay. And so, you know, the claim was that the Alabama legislature had gone heavily, you know, Republican and had used the power to pack all the minority voters into minority districts, as otherwise would seem to be required by the Voting Rights Act. And so, in keeping with the law then in effect, the plan by the Republican legislature was presented to the Justice Department, where one Eric Holder signed off on it. So naturally, you know, there was a lawsuit by the Democrats claiming that this was a racial gerrymander. That ultimately did not get decided on the merits by the Supreme Court because having looked at the claim that the parties actually brought, Justice Breyer decided that the case really should have been tried on a different theory and that the plaintiffs should have picked a different claim, which he then wrote for them and sent them back for another trial. Justice Scalia thought that this might be not necessarily fully in keeping with the federal rules of civil procedure or how these things work, but there you have it. More interesting is we have the Arizona Independent Redistricting Commission. As some of you may know, since you know the earliest dawn of the republic, you know the legislature of each state has engaged in you know the apportionment. This is not entirely accidental. There is a clause of the Constitution that says that the legislature thereof gets to do this. The issue in this case is whether the voters of Arizona, in a good government move, could by plebiscite or by referendum choose a commission to do this instead of the legislature. To no one's shock, you know the legislature actually thought that this would be its job and sued over it. And in an opinion that was 5-4, the court actually disagreed with the Arizona legislature and came up with the somewhat surprising conclusion that legislature does not mean legislature. You know, the legislature also means, you know, the people or the greater polity or, you know, I don't know who. Chief Justice Roberts was somewhat exercised by this. He pointed out that the Constitution uses the word a legislature 17 times or so. More fundamentally, for those of you who are as old as Doug and actually do recall the original Constitution, it did provide that for the election of senators by the legislature of each state. Of course, that had to be changed by the 17th Amendment to provide for direct election by the voters of the state. And as the Chief Justice pointed out, what chumps. They just have, you know, they should have just asked the current court to say that the legislature actually meant the people. There was no point in passing, you know, the 17th Amendment. Armstrong versus Exceptional Child Center, you know, resolved the important question whether the Supremacy Clause gives you an implied right of action to challenge state laws as preempted by federal law. I think enough said. Turning to one of the more interesting and entertaining cases of the term, we have Sivotofsky versus Kerry. Now, this is a very important case. It's also very interesting. You know, under a federal law, children who are born to American parents in Jerusalem are entitled upon request to have the place of their birth noted in their passport as Israel and also in the certificate of birth abroad. Presidents of both parties have declined to enforce this on the theory that is an infringement of the executive's power to recognize foreign governments. And since this is a very sensitive subject, they will not comply with an act of Congress. Now, it's a very unusual case because it's a rare case that is really in the bucket number three of Justice Jackson's steel seizure case, right? It's a case in which, you know, the president can only rely on his own powers minus anything that Congress could validly have, which is a really a rare case. The court sided with the executive in this case, sort of 5-4, 6-3, depending on how you count, claiming that, concluding, you decide, that this is, in fact, in violation of the recognition power, and that only the president gets to do this. Justice Thomas was sort of in the middle. He did agree with the majority that as to the passports, this was an infringement of the recognition power. He, as you may recall, is the most originalist and faithful to the original meaning of the Constitution. He has a very narrow view of congressional power, and part of what was driving him in this case was the conclusion that there was no delegated power to Congress that actually justified this, and that therefore nothing to take away that could take away, you know, from the recognition power by the president. But he split the baby in a very interesting way. He concluded that the passport was as, you know, that as to the passport issue, that would infringe the recognition power. But as to the certificate of birth abroad, he concluded that that was fully justified by Congress's power over naturalization. And so in case you're keeping note, somebody should tell Senator Cruz that the most conservative member of the Supreme Court appears to think he's a naturalized citizen. That is Sivotofsky. And here we come at last on constitutional cases to Obergefell versus Hodges. I think Doug pretty much already has quoted all of the relevant language from the case. You know, it's gotten a lot of commentary. I think everybody should read all of the opinions in the case. They're really informative. Some of them, not necessarily in a way you would think. But in any event, they're all very informative, and they all should be read by everybody. And so we have already read, you know, the controlling passages. I thought I might turn to some of Justice Kennedy's legal reasoning. But for that, I think I'm going to follow, you know, the best summary around, which is from a website called McSweeney's. And here is, you know, the summary as provided by McSweeney's. Hark, love is love, and love is love is love is love. It is so ordered. Now, to be fair to my old boss, that's a little bit of an exaggeration. It is true that the court declined to pick between due process and equal protection, but you know, the court did write what I think is a compelling opinion on how the Dignity Clause has been reverse incorporated into the Due Process Clause and possibly the Equal Protection Clause. And for those of you who always look to the silver lining and legal documents, there was no mention of international law or the consensus of the international community. I wonder why. Having said all of that, of course, this is the least surprising outcome of the entire term. Everybody knew it was coming. In 1972, in a case called Baker versus Nelson, the same claim had been tendered to the Supreme Court, and the court at the time, in 1972, issued an opinion dismissing the claim for want of a substantial federal question. For those of you who follow the all appellate jurisdiction of the court, that is a ruling on the merits that basically says this is a no claim. Of course, over the years, that was overtaken by Romer, Lawrence, and Windsor, and especially after Windsor, when Justice Scalia very helpfully told the entire world that this compelled the recognition of same-sex marriage, no one was expecting any different outcome. There were very thoughtful opinions issued on practically all the sides. I thought I would share with you some of the parts that Doug has not. From the Chief Justice's opinion, which really is a pan to, you know, the power of the people to make choices for themselves and how we should live in a democracy, comes this paragraph, and I will read from this Chief Justice. Nowhere is the majority's extravagant conception of judicial supremacy more evident than in its description and dismissal of the public debate regarding same-sex marriage. Yes, the majority concedes, on one side are thousands of years of human history in every society known ever to have populated the planet. But on the other hand, there have been extensive litigation, many thoughtful district court opinions, countless studies, papers, and more than 100 amici briefs. What would be the point of waiting for the democratic process? The Chief Justice goes on to say. The answer is surely there in one of those amici briefs. Now, that was somewhat understated. Justice Scalia was not quite so understated. He referred to some of the stylistic idiosyncrasies of the majority opinion in very unkind ways. He said, for example, the opinion is couched in a style that is as pretentious as its content is egotistic. He had a footnote who said that if he ever, you know, even as the prize for a fifth vote, wrote an opinion that read like that, he would hide his head in a bag. He went on to say, the Supreme Court of the United States has descended from the disciplined legal reasoning of John Marshall and Joseph Story to the mystical aphorisms of the fortune cookie. I thought that was a bit harsh. He took up, you know, the passage that Doug read earlier about how, you know, this is from the majority opinion, The nature of marriage is that through its enduring bond, two persons together can find other freedoms, such as expression, intimacy, and spirituality. And says Justice Scalia, really? Whoever thought that intimacy and spirituality, whatever that means, were freedoms? And if intimacy is, one would think freedom of intimacy is abridged rather than expanded by marriage. Ask the nearest hippie. Expression, sure enough, is a freedom, but anyone in a long-lasting marriage will attest that that happy state constricts rather than expands, when one can prudently say. So that is what Justice Scalia had to say in his more polite form. We have other federal statutory cases. You know, we have the Inclusiveness Communities Project, where the court concluded, in an opinion by Justice Kennedy, that there was, in fact, a disparate impact claim under the Housing Act. And of course, I am now getting to the most important statutory claim at all, King versus Burwell. Now, this is a really complicated case involving a number of interrelated provisions, some of them in French and in Latin. You need really heavy statutory tools to sort of unearth what might be sort of at issue in this statute. You know, the relevant language says that if you were going to get a subsidy under the Affordable Care Act, you have to be a member of an exchange, and I will quote, established by the state under Section 1311. Now, the act, of course, contemplates that states may not establish exchanges, and it does contemplate that the federal government will step into their place and come up with a federal exchange, and those federal exchanges are established under Section 1321. And so the question before the court was, if you're a member of an exchange established by the Secretary of HHS under Section 1321, are you a member of an exchange established by the state under Section 1311? In a triumph of expedience over literacy, the answer turns out to be yes, you are a member. I will say that, you know, there is much that is unsatisfactory about how we come to this conclusion. There are purported ambiguities in the word such that don't actually seem to bear on any of the actually relevant language. What's interesting to me from just a pure, legal point of view is that there are, canons and ways of getting to this outcome, but the Chief Justice spurned both of them. If you go back to the 19th century, there's a very famous canon of construction, the Holy Trinity canon, which really places the purpose of the statute over anything else, including its text. Now, the Chief Justice basically did that, but he was disinclined to invoke the Holy Trinity canon by name, presumably because it is, in this day and age, in very bad odor. People don't do law that anymore, or at least they didn't used to, since, several decades ago. Now, there's a second avenue, right, which is in keeping with what the New York Times, Paul Krugman, Slate, everybody on the left, which is the typo theory, right? And there is a perfectly, respectable argument to be made sometimes in the statute that Congress goofed and it's a Scrivener's error. That too is a perfectly, respectable thing to say if you can prove it up. The Solicitor General did not go anywhere near making a Scrivener's error argument. So we have sort of an interesting outcome in which a federal statute has been read for something that it appears not to say and that it appears to foreclose, based on canons that don't actually explain, the outcome. As Doug pointed out, there was a lot of unhappiness on the part of the dissents about jiggery pokery and applesauce. You can read those for yourself as well. For those interested on where this might lead us, if anywhere, it's interesting to me that this case joins the Brandon Williamson case from the 90s dealing with cigarettes as the type of thing where the court thinks is too important to actually leave to agency deference. You may recall that HHS actually had come up with a regulation attempting to justify this outcome, and one of the interesting aspects of this case is that this case was not decided on the basis of administrative law. It was not a Chevron case. The chief said it was not a Chevron case. This is too important for an agency. And so now we have sort of a greater number of cases that are potentially implicated if they are really important enough to get a get out of jail card out of the Chevron framework, which is interesting and perhaps a significant contribution. Now I see that I am coming to a close and you people are yawning and the coffee people have not been by, which is sort of unfortunate. And so I'm just gonna finish up by giving you sort of a little list of some of the cases that are already on deck for the court. Affirmative action is coming back. You know, the Fisher case is back at the Supreme Court. We have the Tyson Foods case, which deals with class cert issues in the wake of Comcast and Dukes. Spokeo versus Robbins deals with the question whether Congress may grant Article III standing upon a plaintiff who suffered no concrete injury. We also have, in the Friedrich case, you know, the question whether the court finally will get around, to overruling the Abood line of cases, which was sort of hinted at in the Harris versus Quinn case a couple of terms ago. And we have in the Evanwell versus Abbott case, a voting rights case, as to what the one man, one vote principle actually means, whether you look at the voter population instead of all the inhabitants. Finally, and this is coming too, Whole Woman's Health versus Cole. Deals with the Texas abortion restrictions that were recently upheld by the Fifth Circuit. On Wednesday, the 29th of June, on the way out of town, the court stayed the Texas statute. The four conservative justices noted that they would have declined to stay. So as things currently stand, the court is waiting for that cert petition, and Justice Kennedy has already voted with the liberals to stay the law. You know what that probably means. And that's all I have. Thank you for being so patient.
So if folks have questions, we have some microphones circulating somewhere in the back. Just raise your hands, please.
Kurt Levy, Committee for Justice. Mr. Estrada, I think we're all frustrated at this way the Supreme Court term ended. Certainly you are, and there have been a lot of people proposing ways to address it. I mean, from extra constitutional ways like just resisting on the state level to subjecting Supreme Court justices to retention votes. I'm sure you're familiar with the various proposals out there. Do you support any of them? Do you think any of them stand a chance? Or do we just have to basically sit there and take it and hope that with enough Republican presidents, we can swing the court?
You know, I don't know of all of the proposals. Many of them strike me as things that might come out of the Yale faculty, right? I mean, you know, this is how the Sixth Amendment would work if Derrida had written it. The fact is, it's very difficult to come up with a constitutional amendment. I would say in our political climate, it is impossible. It is possible as well to become despondent too quickly. You get a term of court, which is sort of a random sample of things that just happened to land there at that time. I think you may feel about this a little bit differently next year when the issues are affirmative action and abortion than you do about, you know, the term this year. I mean, as a practical matter, I think, you know, obviously there is never anything to be gained by being a group or a party or a circle of individuals whose avowed purpose is to defy the Supreme Court of the United States. That rarely turns out well for the people doing the defying. I think, you know, sit and take it is perhaps a derisive way of expressing it. But the fact is, you know, we have a system that we have, and, you know, people vote, and if people don't like it, vote for somebody else who will appoint different judges. Going once? Right here.
Paul Noe, American Force and Paper Association. Could you commented a little bit on the Chief's discussion of Chevron in the Obamacare case. When you string that together with what the court said in the mortgage bankers case and Thomas's concurrence, in the Michigan v. EPA case. Where are we with the Chevron doctrine and court deference to agencies generally?
I think that's a very interesting question, and I think a very interesting sort of thing to think about for the future. I think that there are several members of the court. For those of you who are not aware of this, Justice Thomas wrote a concurrence in the EPA case, the $9.6 billion case, suggesting that the Chevron doctrine as a whole may possibly be unconstitutional. He was alone in that opinion, but he was joined by Justice Alito and Scalia in the Perez case, where he suggested that at least with respect to agencies, deference to its own regulations, that may be a doctrine whose due date has gone. I think there is some ferment on the part of the right of the court that is designed to curb the powers of administrative agencies. I would not read too much in it because, of course, three votes is not five. And if we get a concurrence from somebody who is a strange new respect candidate, as we used to say in the district in the 1990s, Justice Kennedy or Justice Breyer, maybe you could think that that's going someplace. I think at the moment it's sort of intellectually interesting, but not particularly likely to bear fruit in the near term. That's not to say that people who practice in this area should not keep those things in mind in order to make sure that those things are saved in appropriate cases for presentation to the court. Oh, back there. Well, I think, all of these things have to be considered. I think it is unlikely that we're going to get Congress to pass and the President to sign any sort of, restriction on the administrative state at present. And so I tend to view proposals like that as things to think about when you actually have, the votes and somebody at 1600 Pennsylvania. I mean, right now it's an interesting project, but it doesn't really advance, the ball unless you're able to come up with enough votes to override a veto. And so it's an interesting thought, but again, like the constitutional amendment sort of aspect of it, somewhat impractical. I think if you really want to pick at the cupidity and often stupidity of the administrative state, it's far more productive to pick particular strands of idiocy and hold them up to public scrutiny and force members of the other party to stand up and actually defend it. I think it is easier to target actual instances of you really can't mean this than to come up with a programmatic way of trying to fix the problem that will cause one party never to vote for it and most members of the other party and the people who vote for them to yawn. Anything else?
I know there's a lot of cases this term, but I was wondering about your opinion on the North Carolina Dental Board case of the FTC, because I think that's going to have a lot of impact on state government.
Well, here's the issue. This is a case where since Parker versus Brown in the 1940s, there's an antitrust doctrine that says that the states get a pass from the antitrust laws, right? And state agencies do too. In the 1970s and 80s, sort of state got into the game of basically delegating authority to private parties to engage in basically cartel behavior. And in the 1980s, in one of the last opinions by Justice Powell, I think City of Eau Claire and those cities, the court basically, and maybe a little bit early in the Mid-Cal case, the court tightened up, the requirements for the Parker versus Brown exception to require that the activity by a private party who purports to be acting for the state be really actively supervised by the state. And I think all the court did with respect to the FTC case was to say as a fact, really, that if you turn, the regulation of dentists to the dentists and basically ignore them, that's not actively supervised, and you're basically trying to license a cartel in violation of Parker versus Brown. I don't view that case as particularly significant other than as a fact-bound application of the Parker versus Brown doctrine, and more specifically of the Eau Claire, city of Eau Claire qualification that you really have to actively supervise, the private party.
Miguel, thank you for doing this. I want to go back to the administrative state for a moment. When I was in law school, we learned that Chevron deference was a good thing from a conservative perspective, because if a statute was unclear and someone was going to pick one of many plausible interpretations, it was better to have politically accountable agencies do it than unelected judges do it. And so I always thought Chevron deference was a good thing. But now conservatives seem to be turned against Chevron deference, and I'm wondering why and whether you have any comment on that.
I don't think there is I don't think it is really fair to say that conservatives as a whole have turned away from Chevron deference. I think that there is a certain level of disenchantment with the premise that supposes that there is accountability for agency action. There is so much agency activity, and it's such a hydra-headed monster that there is not enough notoriety other than for the worst excesses for it really to lead to accountability. I think the more fundamental problem is not with the existence of the doctrine as a whole, is by efforts, driven in large part by the current administration's failure or inability to get its political appointees confirm, or to get things to Congress to try to shove things into administrative agencies, and the expectation that with new appointees on the courts, you are going to have a faster track through step one of the Chevron analysis. I think the Chevron analysis, in many cases, is perfectly unobjectionable, even under a political accountability doctrine, if you really do exhaust every effort that you can make and use every available canon of statutory interpretation to ascertain whether Congress had an intent on the question. But the problem is that there is this issue and an inclination on the part of administrations of both parties who want to use agencies to skip over the Chevron step one when they're in power, and to claim that Chevron step one is really an obstacle when they're out of office. And so in that sense, there's no agreement as to what the framework really is. Oh, thank you. All right. Okay. Thank you. Paul, you got a question?
Just real quick, Paul Kaminar. The Yates case reminded me of the frozen lobster tail case, McNabb, that we worked on together. What do you make of the dissent in the Yates case where Kagan, joined by the three liberal justices, did decry over criminalization and abusive prosecution? Do you see that as a good sign? Report on that.
I mean, I think that there is a lot of, there is a reflex of everybody with a pet theory that if the theory is important to you personally, that there has to be a federal crime that goes with it. And I think that's a bad use of our criminal powers. It's a bad use of cell space. I think just so that everybody can cut up, in the Fish case, Justice Kagan, joined by Justice Scalia and two other justices, took a very literal view of what a tangible object is, which would be, as I think I made clear, perfectly defensible if the context of the statute did not at least strongly suggest that this was a tangible object in which you can make entries. And I think, because she understood that the reading was unpalatable, she tried to put it off on Congress by saying that this really is a stupid statute and we make too many things crimes, but this is what Congress did and that's their problem. And I think that's all fair. It is also true that her textual analysis in the Yates case, which you might think is actually very rigorous, was nowhere in evidence in the Obamacare case. And so I'm not actually sort of confident that this is anything other than a placeholder in this opinion to say that the text makes me do it, but it's really Congress's fault.
Thank you. Thank you for a wonderful job, Miguel. And I'm not quite sure whether this is to console yourself with any of the results this year, or to celebrate a good decision next year, or to console yourself with a bad decision next year. But since you've received, I think, more than one copy of the Federalist Papers from us, please accept and enjoy this for whatever consolation it may bring as time is needed. Thanks so much.
It's an Irish way.